That's it. Before we got there, that's morning time. Before we got there, that's morning time. Before we got there, that's morning time. Before we got there.
Welcome back to another episode of Podward State. I'm Grace Cunningham.
My name is Sam Brungo. We got a special episode coming for you guys. We have former Onward State, former Podward State host, founder of the show, making his return back from the dead for one episode. Our friend Matt Ogden. Matt, how are you?
I'm good. I just got dug up this morning. I'm back.
Are you achy from being in your coffin?
Yeah, I'm achy. I'm creaky. I'm covered in soil.
What have you been up to, man?
Well, since graduation, I got a job. I got one of those things called jobs. Yeah, I'm doing. I'm not doing anything journalism or podcast related. Sadly, I'm doing. I'm just doing digital marketing, but I'm enjoying myself. Awesome. I've been back in town a couple times, but
yeah, we hit the brew
studio. I am a little jealous that Belisario rolled out this gorgeous studio right after I graduated, but that's fine.
It's awesome. We love it. Nice. But we wish you were here. But Matt is joining us for a conversation with Miller McCormick, who's an artist, a Penn State grad 2012 that me and Matt had been talking about for what, 3 years now? Two and a half? Like two and a half years.
Yeah, pretty much.
We've been talking about this conversation. He is the older brother of Pittsburgh rapper Mac Miller and did all of his album work. So he has, if you think about it, he might be like one of the more famous artists, like as far as people that seen his work, like in the world.
Yeah.
Right? Like,
probably.
Even if you don't know,
I agree.
But you've just seen it.
You're definitely familiar with his work.
I've always thought like Mac Miller and his albums, and especially his album artwork, have always been really neat and very like highly conceptual, and like vastly different. Like, each project was vastly different from one another, so it was really cool to get to talk to the guy who put those visions into actual visual art.
Yeah, definitely. So. Appreciate you coming back and talking to us. We are going to have some headlines here with Stutz and Teagan and Jordy, and then afterwards we are going to have sports chat with Pegs and Charlie and Connor Krause.
Joining us for headlines, we have Teagan and Jordan. Teagan, how are you?
I'm good. How are you, Hailey?
I'm really good. Happy Groundhog Day.
Oh yeah. Six more weeks of winter.
Yeah.
Right?
Doesn't feel like it because it's 40 degrees out today.
Yeah, it was warm today.
Yeah. What you got for us, Teagan?
Once again, State College is the city of Thon. Thon is back in person for this year after being virtual in 2021. Select participants will stand from 6 p.m. on Friday, February 18th until 4 p.m. on Sunday, February 20th. Last year, there were 592 dancers who stood for Thon online. This year, there'll be 667 dancers ready to be back in the BJC.
Nice.
That's awesome.
Yeah. Super excited.
I'm excited to experience my first Thon.
Oh my gosh.
I've also never actually been to Thon.
Really?
Yeah, because I went home freshman year and then last year was virtual.
Wow.
Yeah. Weird.
Well, I had mini Thon in high school.
I never did mini Thon. But Thon is fun. It's like kind of crazy.
Yeah, I would imagine.
A lot of people, a lot of signs.
Okay.
The Creamery renamed Strawberry Flavor for PA Pink Zone. For all of February, the Berkey Creamery will rebrand its strawberry flavor as PA Pink Zone Strawberry. The temporary change is part of a continued effort to support PA Pink Zone, a nonprofit breast cancer organization that works to promote breast cancer awareness and aid survivors. The newly named flavor is available for purchase in half-gallon sizes both online and in-store. A portion of the proceeds will be given directly to PA Pink Zone too.
That's nice.
Yeah, that's good. I like seeing like breast cancer awareness stuff like not in October because I feel like we only see it in October. And since Sam's not here for headlines, I'll say it now. Donate some blood. Save a life.
Ooh.
are four Penn Staters to participate in the 2022 Winter Olympic Games. A mix of four Penn State student athletes, coaches, and former stars will compete in this year's Winter Olympic Games in Beijing. Jessica Adolfsson, a former Penn State women's hockey player who graduated in 2021, will represent Team Sweden. Penn State women's hockey assistant coach Allison Kumi will serve as a coach for Team USA during this year's game. Penn State men's hockey director of operations Alex Dawes will also serve as coach for this year's Olympics while representing Team USA men's hockey. World Campus student Caitlin Hawaiik will compete for Team USA along with partner Jean Luke Baker in ice dance.
That's awesome.
Yeah, that is cool. Cool. I couldn't imagine being in the Olympics.
Do you ever see and like they're like they say someone your age, they're like, and it'll be like a 21-year-old from wherever like really is doing this really impressive thing. And I'm like, whoa.
I like watching the things on TikTok where they have all their like merch that they get.
Mm-hmm.
It's so fun.
Yeah.
I'm pretty sure it's like Skims. Like
they
Kim
Kardashian.
No, I'm pretty sure that's like what it is.
Nuh-uh.
I think it is.
Like Kim Kardashian.
Yes. Actually, someone just told me that and I like believed it.
Yeah, I feel like that's a lie.
Because she's like really famous. I don't know.
I feel like it's always like Nike.
Yeah, I was going to say Nike or Under Armour, but.
Well, it's like different stuff because they do like Ralph Lauren too.
Oh, that's
polo.
Cool. Well, shout out Penn State athletes and coaches.
That's cool.
Team Sweden ice hockey.
Yeah, cool.
Mm-hmm.
Thanks, Teagan. Jordan, how are you?
I'm great.
Oh.
How are you?
Okay. Wait, what?
How are you, Hayley?
I'm good, Jordan. How are you?
I'm fantastic.
That's good.
Hope you had a great week so far.
You know, I did. Mom, I know you're watching this, and I did not tell you that I did really, really, really bad on my Astro exam today. Like, really
like
bad.
Like, Astro 1?
Yeah.
Wait, the video game class?
Yeah. The exam.
Wait,
the exam,
wait. Oh the video God, game Hayley. One or the, or like.
It's a video game one, oh. But the exams are in the Pollock Testing Center, so I couldn't use
I didn't even know there was, like, tests
so
for that.
Mom, just know that I can drop my lowest test grade score. So
wait, I took
I took
Astro, not the
yeah, I took
not
it
the
person.
Video game one. I took it in person freshman year, and it was I think it was my worst grade I've ever got.
Really,
like at school. Yeah,
I love that class. I've always been
so
into,
bad.
Like, space
they were like talking
shit.
About like getting like crushed in like a black hole, and I was
really?
Like, I don't get it.
I was like scary into that class.
It freaked me out.
I almost switched to astronomy.
All right.
Well, champs. Champs Downtown announced the return of its brunch menu. According to manager Dante Lucchesi, brunch will be served every Sunday from 11 a.m. to 2 p.m. every Sunday. It's open to all ages unless there's a special event on tap. The menu features items including creme brulee, French toast, avocado toast, birthday pancakes, and breakfast pizza. Signature cocktails include a $3 mimosa, $3 brunch box, and a $4 Revitalite balm.
The photos look like vile.
Really?
Look at
even
the
eggs. Revitalite balm?
No. It's just a food.
So, do you guys like know what Revitalite is? Grace
That's,
might
yeah.
not because she's not 21.
I'm not.
But
thank you, Jordan,
what?
For reminding us.
Revitalite's
That's
like
disgusting.
A drink,
right?
You know,
Wait,
like keep you from getting like hungover.
Yep.
Yeah.
Brianna Chicken Fry makes her own.
So like, would that just like counteract the hangover?
Yes.
Like, how many Revitalites could I drink before, like Revitalite bombs would I have to drink before, like, I'm feeling like shit the next day?
Brother, there's only one way to find out.
Yeah, you have to test it out.
We're making a trip,
know.
Dude.
Let us know.
All right.
Next
I'll let
week.
You know. And then this was everywhere today and stuff. Donald P. Belisario College of Communications suffered the loss of Professor Kurt Chandler, who died of cancer on January 31st. Before he spent 15 years teaching at Penn State, Chandler was an award-winning photojournalist. Outside of teaching, Chandler consistently advocated for student media groups on campus. Belisario Dean Marie Harden wrote in an email to students early Tuesday morning and said he was the kind of teacher who made a difference in the lives of students he taught, making himself available around the clock. He encouraged you to stretch your imagination and do work you never imagined you could do. Harden also shared that there will be an event later this month to honor Chandler. I remember That's having his class. It was my first comm class I had at Penn State. And I was just always so excited to, like, go to it. Mm-hmm. Like, you never knew, like, what we were going to be talking about that day. He made it fun and interesting. Like, he was really just one of the nicest people ever. Like, I met him, too, through comm radio. Like, he took our headshots my freshman year. And just literally one of the nicest people I've ever met.
Yeah. That's really sad.
Yeah, I never had him, but I heard a lot about him. And I know a lot of people thought very highly of him, so rest in peace.
Yeah, what I think, like, really stands out is, like, through, like, all the Twitter posts and everything I've seen, everybody seems to have, like, different stories
mm-hmm.
about him and, like, form connections with him. So I think that just really speaks to what kind of person he was.
Yeah, everyone has something to say about him, so.
Just to talk about Kurt, I also had him my first semester, and I was, like, super, like, anxious about photojournalism, and he took me on a trip to this, like, fair, and it was, like, this little thing, and we got to write a story. It was my first photojournalism thing ever, and kind of got me started. So I kind of attribute a lot of my success and where I'm at now to his guidance, so he's a great guy.
Thanks.
Okay, that's it for headlines. Now for our conversation with Miller McCormick.
Joining us now, we have Penn State alum and artist Miller McCormick calling in from Los Angeles. Miller, how are you? Welcome to Podward State.
Thanks for having me. Hey, guys. How are you?
Doing good. So our first question, a little bit before your time at Penn State, you obviously are from a very talented artistic family. How did you get into art at a young age, and when did you figure out what part of art was going to be kind of your avenue?
Thanks for saying that. How did I know? I mean, I think I wanted to be an artist when I was a little kid. I just used to draw, and it was very, like, welcomed, say, by my folks and family in general. My father kind of was, I mean, he's alive, but he is kind of he's not really practicing. He was an architect, I guess. And then my mom is a photographer. Yeah, so they welcomed it, did like art classes at the Carnegie Museum. Used to have like public drawing classes and stuff for kids. And there's a lot of stuff like that in Pittsburgh, I guess, for kids, or there was. And yeah, and then just like regular art classes, just like anybody else. I hopefully they still do those today in schools, but they did then. And high school art teacher, she was like, oh, maybe you should do graphic design. I was like, okay, that sounds cool. I didn't know what it was. I thought it was advertising, so I didn't want to do it. Because I just thought advertising was evil, and didn't know how I felt about advertising at the time. And got to Penn State and had no idea what I was doing still. I thought I was going to do turf grass management. And then I remember talking to Bill Kelly, was awesome guy who was leading the, I don't know what the, like, section of the school was in general, but he was like one of the counselors. And I feel like he walked me through what the options were, like, just based on interests. And there were a couple other counselors there too. But anyway, they were all great, and ended up in a introductory class with it was Bill Kelly and Lanny Samiz. And Ryan Reynolds, who I think is still he's running the show at Penn State. He's one of the folks running the show. And I thought it was really cool, and it sounded really cool, and the work that they were showing. And I realized that I had no idea what it was, and it looked fun and kind of encompassed anything that someone would want to do potentially as, you know, from video to posters to music packaging. It was kind of like anything you could dream up. There was kind of like a path for it in the overall spectrum of graphic design, whatever that, you know, means.
So you mentioned it a little bit, but what was your journey like finding Penn State, and how did you decide to attend?
I guess, okay, so Alderdice in Pittsburgh, that's the high school, good old Taylor Alderdice. Great place. And I think just like growing up in Pittsburgh, Penn State, in state school, it was more affordable. And Penn State was the only school that I got into. So I did not get in. I applied to maybe one other school. But so, yeah, I visited and it was great. I saw the squirrels running around campus and all the people. And it looked like a really good place to go. I still had no idea what I wanted to do, but it just seemed like a good place to go and figure it out.
What are some of your favorite memories from being at Penn State?
A lot of college pizza. I hope you guys don't eat like we did back then. I hope there are healthier options.
There's healthier options, but we still eat college pizza.
I actually worked at Subway for a day.
Really?
Yeah.
Which one? There's like five now.
It was the one that was across the street from, it's like across the street from a mini mart.
Why only a day? What happened?
The lunch rush. It was like, I was intimidated. I thought it would be a fun place to work. And I got like the full like name tag and uniform and hat. And night after, I like slipped a note under the floor.
That said I quit?
Yeah, I guess so.
That's a good idea.
I just like didn't think I was the right fit for the job. I thought somebody else should take the position.
So last week we had multimedia journalist that like went viral last week because in the middle of her live newscast, she got hit by a car and she went to Penn State. So we had her on. I don't know if you saw that clip. Did you?
Me?
Yeah. Of her getting hit by a car.
It was like a viral video. Yeah.
That's awful. Is she okay?
Yeah, she's okay. But when she came on, we were like, asking her questions and she said, oh yeah, I got hit by a car in college. Just like everyone.
Like, yeah, she's like, everyone gets hit by a car at Penn State.
I never got hit by a car, but I thought there was always the thing about if you got hit by a bus, you get free tuition.
Is that a thing?
That's, people just say that. It's not like real. Like you would just get like, I mean, if you ran in front of the bus, you wouldn't get any money, I don't think.
So people still talk about that.
Yeah, yes. People do still talk about that.
That is still a rumor.
Weird, because that seems like it would be a good reason to jump in front of a bus. Like, if you're...
Yeah. I think if you jumped in front of the bus, it wouldn't count. But if, like, they ran a stop sign, maybe.
Okay. Okay, yeah. There's probably cameras and... Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, I have... It's actually the only reason that I got into the design program. So there's like portfolio review and I used to not sleep very much when I was in the program. And I was kind of like getting the portfolio together and I was running a little bit late and I won't say the name, but a professor in a different, I was basically working like late at night in a different classroom, not in the Borland design building. And a professor who I didn't, that, you know, had no idea, we didn't know each other. They just, you know, saw like a spread of I was working on my portfolio and they must have walked into their classroom and saw it on a desk and they just threw it out the window into the trash. And so that was like the day before. So I don't think, I didn't turn in a portfolio on like the morning that it was due. I don't think I did, or it was like, I must've cobbled something together and it was just awful. Like didn't get it done. I kind of like had the opportunity to explain what happened and got a second shot at putting my portfolio together. And I remember I like didn't leave my apartment for like, I just slept for 48 hours and cried. Friendships from being in that program, it was like a little bit like, boot camp, I would say. The, you know, you spend, end up spending a lot of time with, it's like Penn State, there's a lot of people and you end up with 15 folks in a design, like in a studio setting for every day. But that was cool to like, big state school was kind of scary to me, social anxieties and whatnot. So smaller version, you know, inside of the big machine was cool. So a lot of good memories from the design program, folks like Phil Kelly, and I'm trying, there's somebody who I would not have graduated without her help. She was another counselor in the program. I would have failed. I mean, I could not pass math classes for the life of me. I failed racquetball. Like anything outside of the design program, I just didn't. So I ended up being there for an extra semester just to finish math. And like not even difficult math, like algebra. I could not. Yeah. So does everybody here pass their math?
No. Classes? I failed twice. Two math classes, had to retake them.
I passed, but it's hard. Had to take it during the summer when I had no other classes so that I could like focus on it, and it was hard and it was algebra. So
and for us with when COVID happened, like I got to take my math online. That's the only reason, like COVID is the only reason I passed math.
I wonder if there's it's great though. You passed math.
I know, you're right. Now I'm about to graduate and I did it with the help of COVID.
Yay.
But no, I feel the same way. Like definitely it being in a smaller program like you were with your design, it like kind of dumbs down such a big university and you find your people. I remember I was a photo minor, so I was in Borland a lot, and it's you see the same people in the halls every single day, and you like get to know them, get to know their faces just because you're going to class there every day and you get to like recognizing them. So yeah, it's definitely a good way to smallen your group. What's the word for that? Shrink your group.
Smallen.
We can go with smallen.
Yeah, smallen it. Yeah, smallen it down.
I was gonna say smallify, even smallify. Though like I know that's not a word, but like that's what I was thinking.
Smallify it down.
Yeah.
Somebody on The Bachelor. I think that show is so bad and f***ed up in so many ways, but
it's entertaining.
I said truthfully.
Truthfully,
not truthfully. He said truthfully.
That's bad. What a red flag.
It's like library.
Library. Maybe he just had a little bit of an accent.
Say Pittsburgh.
Well, that's like Pittsburgh East. You're saying Pittsburgh. That's like everyone says Pittsburgh.
Yeah.
So you graduated from Penn State in 2012, correct?
Yeah.
During that time, that year, while you were at Penn State, your brother went on his college tour, and one of the spots was BJC. What was it like for you to be able to be at school while he played at like the biggest venue in town?
So yeah, it was really special. I think a year before then, he performed in like a couple of fraternity houses, and maybe also like one of the smaller bars. So that was, you know, like a year later to be maybe a couple. No, it was probably because that was a Macadelic tour. Yeah, we're coming up on 10 years in March. Yeah, it was amazing. I don't know. It was crazy because literally like 2 years before then, it was just, you know, like a soggy fraternity living room. So, that's just because that's what, you know, that was cool too. That just, it was just different.
But I remember it because, like, at that time, I was in, what, fifth grade, sixth grade or something? How old are you when you're 12?
Sixth grade.
And it was, like, I knew who he was and stuff. And then I didn't know that because I had met you that through that project that you did. And then I didn't know that he was your brother until the, like, reality show on MTV, and you were like in an episode. I was like, oh, that guy looks really familiar. And I like figured it out. Do you know what I'm talking about?
That's so crazy, actually, that that's the connection.
Yeah. And like now I'm a film major and I'm a photographer, and it's like that was my first anything like that. So it kind of sparked that. And I was always like an artistic, creative kid, but that like sparked in me like what I do now. So it was really cool that. That was an experience.
Sorry I ruined your life.
I know, right? Now I'm gonna be a starving artist. No, it's okay. I love it. It's like, and to be like in Borland, I remember like the first time I was there, I was like, it looks like familiar here. Because for some reason, that's like a core memory of mine. Because like when I was growing up, I had like the biggest crush on Audrey. It was like she was in college and I was like six. But it was like, I don't know. For some reason, that's like a core memory of mine. So like going back to Borland, I was like, oh, this looks like familiar. I don't know why. But then it all clicked at some point. But
she probably set that up. That's so.
She did. Yeah. Because you probably were like, I need like children, but I don't know any children. And she was like, oh, I know children.
Yeah. She was also.
Yeah. She was local.
Yeah.
Yeah. But anyways.
I forgot about that. What do you guys do?
I'm advertising actually the Evil Craft.
Oh shit, sorry. It's not
it's okay.
No. It's not evil. I just thought I was like 16 and was subscribing to Adbusters magazine, and you know, I ended up working in advertising for like 2.5 years. So that's awesome. That's cool. I'm sorry for what I said.
No, I thought it was funny. I didn't take it to heart.
I knew that I was going to regret saying that as soon as I said it too. I'd like.
The Penn State photography like program kind of made me like hate it. I don't know. I'm sure you can relate to this. It's like doing stuff that for classes and like eventually like working in a job where you have to do stuff that's like not what you want to do, and but it's like a creative thing like that.
Do you think you'd need to practice it more outside of like an independent practice to love it in a way?
Well, it's just like doing stuff that other people are telling me to do. It's like I don't know, I feel like it puts me in like a creative box, and I don't know, I'm sure you can relate to that, right, with work.
That's cool, because that gives me a segue to take back more of what I said about how advertising is awful. I think in work, like in the advertising agency, you learn so much of just how to make stuff, regardless of like even working in, you know, a job, which I worked, Chandelier Creative is an incredible place. I loved working there and the people were fantastic. And that totally changed my mind about what it's like to work in advertising. But you just learn a lot. I mean, then you can apply it to whatever you want. Like, I think you end up kind of sharpening skills. And then it's, if you're stuck in something that maybe you don't even really want to do, it's, you know, that you don't have to stay in it. You're kind of like, oh, I want to do this other thing. And that kind of, whatever that vision is, just becomes clearer and clearer. And then you take the, you know, your skills and just apply it to that, or just do that the whole time. Everybody does it in their own way. But yeah, you were asking if I feel the same way.
And like, how do you deal with that and still like do your creative thing when you are working for like an agency or something or whatever it is where they're telling you to do something? Because I at the beginning of college, work for this company. It was like a technology company, and I was doing like film and graphics and video and photo and stuff for them. And it was just like this stuff that I had no interest in. And it was like, I felt like obviously I was doing it to get experience, but also get paid. But it was like, I felt like it was putting me in a box of what I could do creatively. It was like, I had no interest in it. So like, how do you get around that as a someone that does creative work professionally? You know what I mean?
Two things. And there's always two things. I was in a kind of a similar situation. I was working on some stuff and I felt like there were cards for advertisements that say like $30 off and stuff like that. And I was doing like hundreds of these cards. And I was talking to this one designer who I've really looked up to in LA. And I felt like they were doing such cool work. I was like, oh, I'm doing this. And, you know, and he gave me the advice to, he was just like, even in something that seems like the not the most exciting, you know, it's not like your Sistine Chapel or whatever, but there's something that you can do within that that you can learn from, that you can something that you can end up doing well in whatever it is. Doesn't matter, even if something that seems super boring, if there's a corner of it that can, you know, that ends up being, I don't want to say something, yeah, something you're proud of or something that you feel like you just did really well and you can learn from it, then great, you know. I got lucky with working with great people who and like clients and you know, like professors and people in the design studio at Penn State, like that kind of, I don't know, I feel like that ends up making the process becomes so nutritious that you know that like the end product is still important, of course, but when that the process is just like a learning experience and is heartful, that's good stuff.
Nice That actually like leads perfectly into the next question. So like, you know, after you graduate, what was it like, you know, like getting out there, like getting those first jobs? Because like, you know, I feel like in your field, you know, you get jobs by building a network and stuff, which is basically what you just described. You know, you kept in touch with your people from the design school. After you graduate, like, what was that like, you know, like being out there, you know, in the world for the first time and finding jobs?
Scott Batt did a lecture at Penn State, and what he talked about was just the importance and value of the journey itself, rather than, you know, that like everything. I feel like since then, like I heard, I was like, oh, cool, yeah, the journey. And then like as time has gone on a little bit, it feels more true. And it's kind of like with all the shit that's going around, like that's going on all the time. Yeah, that we're just like here to learn, you know. That's like one of the only thing that starts to make sense, that you know, that mindset helps a lot, whether it's a weird job or something even that seems like it's going really well, like that trying to figure out like, oh, am I doing the right thing? So I'm just trying to remember. I ended up staying an extra semester, so it kind of felt like I missed the boat. Everybody went to New York. I stayed in Pittsburgh. I worked at AccuWeather outside of State College for a little bit. They gracefully gave me some work there, and that was fun. But I ended up, yeah, so I was in an internship with a place called Actual Size in Pittsburgh, and those are great folks. They're actually all Penn Staters too. I was working on watching movies packaging for my brother, and I ended up basically leaving Actual Size just to focus on that. I just kind of got obsessed with I couldn't like balance. That's always been my problem. I have a hard time prioritizing and balancing, like really focusing on stuff, for, you know, better or worse. But that was the beginning of trying to freelance out of school, which I ended up doing that for the most part until Chandelier created, where I was like 26. So I tried freelancing for a while and it was okay. I mean, I got lucky in retrospect. Things really sped up when I finally just got a job, and that, you know, like ended up meeting great people and having some kind of a network, and was lucky to get that job.
And I was also I'm also wondering, like, how would your creative process differ when, you know, you would collaborate, you know, with your brother and his projects, as opposed to, you know, your regular collaborators, the ones you knew in college and the ones you've worked with since?
Do you guys have siblings by any chance?
Yeah.
Okay. So imagine the process of trying to figure out what you're doing for dinner with your sibling.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, or trying to, you know, it's just like two people trying to figure something out together, and your siblings. So you're naturally really close, and there's, I don't know, I guess that's like an okay analogy maybe, but
it works.
It's just, you know, it's like, that's family. And so that like made a lot of space for exploring and I think a lot just happened from spending time together. A lot, we were living together, and I was, you know, while we were living together, he was making music, of course, and all the time. And sometimes I'd be, if, you know, got close to like album time, or we just ended up collaborating, or, you know, not music, just me doing design stuff. And yeah, that was great.
What's a piece of art that you've worked on that you're most proud of, both for your brother, whether it was album work or something like that, and then something that you did just on your own, something that you're really proud of your work and that you think is really cool and just means a lot to you?
We were first living together and working on the Faces stuff. That was fun. So I maybe would start there. We were also, there's this place close to us where they had these amazing breakfast burritos, and he started getting they're called like rocket fuel coffees or something like that, like bullet something, I don't know. And never understood why, like, would feel so sick after having these coffees and the burrito. And it turned out that there was like half a stick of butter in the coffee because of the, you know, it was gross. But no,
it's gnarly.
Yeah, right. Do you guys drink coffee?
Like, yeah, like I've never put butter in my coffee. What the hell?
But yeah, anyways, that's also what I've been like closest to the Faces stuff recently since the release. It was the summer after graduating, or when just like wrapping up the design program at Penn State and still hanging around Borland. Just like worked on a show, like a little art show. It was just like there wasn't really an assignment. It was just like a art show in Pittsburgh. and that like Lanny was in this, would be walking through the studio and he'd be like, oh, what are you doing over there or something like that. And I don't know. I always looked up to that dude a lot. So that was cool. I don't know if I have, that's so sad if I don't have like another, not that I've definitely had some work that I'm really grateful for, but I don't, you know, maybe what's next, or I don't think it's happened just yet.
Do you have any words of wisdom for college students or maybe for aspiring artists or young creatives?
Well, I have no idea what I'm doing, really. Not that, you know, so I don't think I'm, but like, no one should look to me for any wisdom, you know, whatsoever. I don't think I'm a reliable source on that, you know, I think recently there's also like people always say like, oh, if I would like look back, I would have done this and this and this. And yeah, but at the same time, like if you would have done that, then you don't know where. So I think all those, you know, stuff that you might want to change helps maybe in some way in the long run. So, yeah, we're just here to learn. I think that's kind of, hopefully that continues. We're just here to learn. That honestly, when I tell myself that, I'll be freaking out about stuff that's going on, or like, oh my God, like I can't figure this out, or I did something wrong, or like that's 90% of my existence is just being anxious about doing the wrong thing. So I think the sentiment of just being here to learn kind of softens that sometimes.
All right. Thank you so much for spending this time with us, for telling some stories, sharing some words of wisdom. Even though you say that you're not a reliable source, it's awesome to hear from another creative. Ladies and gentlemen, Miller McCormick.
But seriously, thank you guys so much for having me. Keep on doing exactly what you're doing. Unless you want to do something different, then do something else. And also want to make sure that, like, you know, I don't know if Ryan Russell listens to this, but that guy, I owe a lot to that person, and Lanny, Samiz, and Kirsten. Yeah, Bill Kelly, just everybody, the Penn State program. Very grateful. The orange couch for the orange couch.
Sounds good. Thanks, Miller. Appreciate it.
Thanks, guys.
Awesome. Okay. Thanks very much to Miller McCormick for stopping by. Very interesting, kind of unique conversation for Podward State this week. It was very fun to listen to you guys talk with them. So thank you very much to him for stopping by. So yeah, a couple things to touch on in sports this week. I think the first one we could run through quickly with football is the stuff that happened with Bryce Mostella. So he's a defensive end on the team. Kind of Saturday afternoon, he drops this Twitter thread about how he accused the team of mental health neglect. He needed to gain weight to be a defensive lineman, and he kind of struggled with that. And it's according to his tweets, it got pretty ugly with specifically James Franklin. He alleged that Franklin kind of told him he didn't care about the team since he was struggling to put on weight. So kind of a bit of a bombshell thing. James was asked about it at his press conference today, which is Wednesday morning. And he kind of he wasn't really allowed to make a comment on it. And he's apparently, according to James, he's not currently enrolled at classes at Penn State. So, yeah, quick takes on that.
Yeah, I mean, all alleged right now, but if that's true, that's really bad stuff. Mm-hmm. Can't have that in your program. That's, yeah. Other than that, just not good.
Yeah, I don't know. The football team's huge, so obviously, I think it's hard for the head coaches to have personal connections with everyone. But if that is true, like you were saying, Charlie, it is pretty alarming. It's just hard to be in that situation because obviously Division I football players, they're all kind of tasked to put on weight and stuff like that. But it's not for everyone, and it seems like a difficult situation.
Yeah, I mean, I think it can be pretty, especially to adjust to that. It's probably a pretty tough environment. You know, all of a sudden you might be like the man in high school, and then you're playing for Penn State, which is pretty, you know, obviously tough program with a lot of really good players. So I think maybe that could add on to it. I know he mentioned depression and anxiety. So, you know, well wishes to him. And if that is true, then I'm sure there will be maybe more that comes out with it. I'm not really sure. But, yeah, kind of tough to speak on it right now. A couple other kind of things that I guess are running parallel to Penn State football. Shout out to Bobby Ingram. He's going to be Wisconsin's offensive coordinator. Guy was an awesome wide receiver for Penn State. Shout out to him and some really good years for the team. And this is something I want to talk about real quick. Arnold Ebiketie, did you see?
Yeah.
Yes.
So Gabe and Jerry wrote kind of a column about it. He was The Athletic wrote a news article about how the NCAA is going to investigate injury faking. A lot of times we might see it with, you know, defenses faking an injury to slow down a hurry-up offense, not usually a huddle offense. But so the featured image was Arnold Ebiketie, obviously former Penn State defensive end, had a really good year for Penn State. He went down with an injury against Iowa. I think everybody kind of knows the Iowa fans booed him. Even P.J. Mustafer, whose injury actually ended up being season-ending. Devon Ellis went down with a quick shoulder injury. So anyway, kind of the point, I guess, of Gabe's piece was that A.K., Arnold Ebiketie, didn't really deserve to be the featured image of that article, even if it wasn't, you know, directed at him. That's kind of a tough look. And even to bring it back up seems weird. But
it's a low blow. I mean, I saw AK tweeted about it earlier, and he said, you know, I don't deserve this or something along those lines. You know, pretty unfair if you ask me, especially after the year he had proved he was one of the better D linemen in college football, and they're going to just throw shade at him. I don't know.
No doubt,
I don't like
it.
Yeah, I think it's just ridiculous that this whole thing wasn't put to bed months ago. Mm-hmm. Because Franklin went on a 5-minute rant about it at the week after the Iowa game, saying that that was just one of their tougher weeks. They had 10 guys in and out of the lineup with injury, 10 starters. Like you said, Will Mustafer's was season ending. Mm-hmm. And then for AK, I mean, he truly injured his knee. I mean, I was at the game. You were at the game.
Yeah.
We saw it. Brisker was hurt, too. It's just kind of crazy that that's still like a point of conversation this time of the season.
Yeah, I mean, I was going back through some of it after, you know, seeing Gabe's article, and it was pretty, I mean, even the fact that Kirk Ferentz, the Iowa head coach, like brought it up even deeper into the week and kind of further accused of him of it. So yeah, I think we're kind of all this on the same page here, and I think people listening to this are going to be on the same page as us too, as Penn State fans. But yeah, so I guess we can close the book on football there. Oh, shout out actually to Vlad Hilling. He is joining the team's performance enhancement staff.
Oh.
He's going to graduate in May, but he was a player on the team. And so now he'll be coaching, so that's pretty exciting.
Come. Jordan has a Vlad Hilling story.
Let's hear it.
So at NSO, I was walking around, and there was, like, two different times whenever, like, these groups of girls walked up to me, and they're like, are you on the football team? Which, you know, for me, a 5'10", like, unathletic-looking male, I was like, what the heck is this? And so they were like, oh, are you on the football team? And I was like, no. And they're like, oh, you look like one of the guys or whatever. And I was like, who the heck are you talking about and everything. Well, later I was hanging out and stuff, and I saw Vlad, and that's who they kept on mixing me up with, because apparently from the back of the head, I look just like Vlad Hilling.
I could see it, man. I could see it. Congrats, yeah. Jordy. I could see that.
I know, right? So, yeah.
Thank you.
I think you look great, Jordy. I think you look great.
Me too, yeah.
I think you guys look great.
Thanks. Oh, man. You didn't need to say that.
Okay, so yeah, I guess with that, I'd rather end football on that note, so thank you, Jordan.
Yeah, beautiful.
And then I wanted to just hit on a couple shout-outs. Penn State women's soccer, a ton of former players are signing with professional teams. Carrie Abello is joining the Orlando Pride. Ellie Jean with Gotham FC. I know Sam Coffey, Portland Thorns, I believe they're called. She signed with them. She was drafted already, but yeah, Portland Thorns. So that's pretty exciting. A lot of former stars for Erica Dombach moving on to the professional ranks. And real quick, shout out to Katie Jones. She broke Penn State women's indoor pole vault record. That's
very cool.
That's impressive.
I did not know that. That's awesome.
Katie. Like, I feel like when I'm watching the Olympics, like pole vaulting, that's like a scary freaking sport.
Yeah, no, I would not.
Like you're just like, you stick a stick in the ground and you, how high do they go? Like 30 feet.
4.27 meters. So.
So what is,
if you want to do the conversion, about 10 feet.
Right? No, no. 4.27 meters is more than 10 feet.
14 feet, actually.
That's fucking crazy.
That's crazy.
That's insane.
Yeah, there's a video of it here. Anna Wiggins wrote an article about it earlier this week. Shout out, Anna. So yeah, very cool. Congrats, Katie. That is
That's
exciting.
Awesome. Good job, Katie.
So I guess those were a quick little sports headline thing. I think we've hit on everything I wanted to talk about. Most recent thing right now, today is Wednesday, February 2nd. Shout out men's basketball. Big win over Iowa Monday night. Really one they needed after dropping three straight, including a tough loss to Iowa over in Carver-Hawkeye. Yeah. Keegan Murray had that crazy tip
that
in to keep
insane.
The game going. Probably going to be a top five pick, so shout out to him. Miles Dredd, though, still clutch, kept it alive.
I was so happy for him.
In overtime.
Coming off of surgery.
And yeah, so awesome win, right?
I mean, Totally.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, it was pretty cool to see Dredd hit that shot, especially since Pickett and Lundy were kind of hot throughout the game. Just for him to kind of step up in the moment and drill it was pretty cool. It was just cool to see, because that's a game Penn State loses 8 out of 10 times,
time.
I think. So for them to kind of like weather the storm of McCaffrey hitting all those threes going into half, and then Dredd had 7 in overtime, and he averages like 5 on the year.
Yeah,
so
that's
pretty cool.
I was happy for him. I've always loved Miles Dredd. I don't know why. He's kind of plays like
the
me.
The guy's nails. He's not necessarily, I mean, his shot isn't always there, but it always feels like he had that one against Rutgers in 2019.
VCU, he had a buzzer
VCU
beater.
Is awesome,
I mean, the guy is just clutch. He really is. So I know there were some Iowa fans on Twitter saying he traveled, but and what was it? Oh, and also shout out to John Harrow. It was coaches versus cancer night.
Yeah.
And he played his butt off. He had another double-double, which is, it just seems like a, you know, that it just happens every night now. But we saw Connor, actually, you wrote an article about it. He lost his dad to cancer, and it was on the kind of cancer awareness night. So very cool. It's a classic John Harrow game. So
yeah, he had his career high in points, which is pretty cool.
That's awesome. Yeah, that's
so,
awesome. Good for
I mean,
John.
4 years, he had 19 points this game.
Wow.
So pretty cool for him.
Yeah, John's the man. Good job, John.
And I guess quickly here, I think we could keep it rolling on the Iowa note. Sorry.
Oh, yeah. Dominance.
Yeah, Penn State Wrestling went in and just took care of business against Iowa and Carver-Hawkeye this past Friday. 19-13 win. Max Dean had an insane comeback. He got near fall points in the third period and kept it alive. Greg Kirkvliet didn't get the win. That was kind of one that was sort of disappointing. But other than that, all the top ranked guys did their job. Won. I mean, they're officially, we said it last week, I think, if they beat Iowa, they're like officially just the best. And obviously, there's still a lot of duels to go. And then we got NCAAs and Big Tens. But it's pretty awesome.
Yeah, for them to jump out to a 10-0 lead, that was super impressive.
That's
I thought it was over at that point.
Me too,
I mean,
yeah.
Iowa made it pretty interesting, so that was cool. But whiteout this week at the BJC.
Yep.
Should be fun.
Gonna be awesome. Yeah, you guys are now listening to this after it, but
we won.
What's that?
We won.
Should we say, yeah, Penn State won.
Penn State rolled Ohio
Penn
State.
State. Friday night.
Yeah. Good job.
I always forget about that.
Awesome. And then I guess instead of, so hockey has, this is going to be after they have Notre Dame this weekend, or am I way off? I should say this is confusing because it's
Minnesota.
Monday. But either way, they are right now on today, Wednesday, February 2nd. They're coming off of a up-and-down series against Ohio State. So right when Penn State's beating of Iowa was starting, Penn State hockey, Guy Gadowski's guys, were beating Ohio State in a shootout. Pretty freaking sick. And
I
think it's only, they only get 2 points. It's not like a full 3-point win, right? Like,
yeah, 2 points. They get 2 points.
Who cares, man? That's the clip of the clip of the shootout winner. I'm blanking on his name
Ben
now.
Schoen.
So, Ben Schoen, thank you.
Yep.
It was awesome. Very cool. Were either of you guys there?
I was there. Yeah, super cool.
I couldn't
cool.
make it this weekend, sadly, but that was awesome. Love seeing that.
How were the vibes?
It was awesome. Yeah. I mean, it was an impromptu whiteout, so it was pretty cool.
That is sick. I mean, Pagula is just the way it's like not
overly big. The student section's
like
the perfect size.
Yeah, it's
like,
right there. Right.
Basketball is just, I mean, BJC, we all have our complaints about that, but the student section's just too big and too wide, so Pagula is awesome.
No doubt. It was very cool. And obviously they lose 6-0 to Ohio State Saturday night, it would have been, which is tough, but I mean, I think we said it last week, you know, splitting a series with Ohio State, a top 15 team in the country, that's kind of a win.
It's definitely a win.
So, yeah, a little momentum for Guy Gadowski's guys right now. We can stick with hockey. Women's hockey, they're awesome. They bounced back, 2-game sweep over Mercyhurst this past weekend, or 2 weekends ago. And then upcoming, they will be playing Who are they playing this coming weekend?
Loading.
Yeah, we got a tough Wi-Fi on campus still. Sorry, guys. So they took down they're playing Syracuse. So this past, it'll be Monday right now, this past Friday night and Saturday afternoon, they have had a, that sounds weird, they've had a series against Syracuse. But yeah, they're still rolling. They're 14-8-3, really solid. Shout out Jeff Campersole. That's, they're kind of like, I think the past few years they've
like, yeah, they're like a, no, they're a wagon. Wagon.
Yeah, 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 definitely.
But yeah, I mean, the Mercyhurst is a good team. That's an awesome win.
Coming off a long break too, I believe.
I know. So, yeah, they had like a 2-week COVID break.
I think there was some question as to how they would bounce back after that, but nah, definitely what they needed.
So shout out to both hockey teams getting it done. We've hit on, let's finish with the Lady Lions. So they are on a bit of a slide. They're at a 9-11 record now, unfortunately. I was actually at, shout out to John Affleck, his Com 412 class. We had an assignment. It was to go, it's sports and society, so we were supposed to go to one of the Lady Lions games and like note, doesn't matter. We were supposed to like note what was happening in the crowd. Anyway, I was there. They had a pretty tough loss to Michigan State, to be honest with you. And then they fell to Maryland just after that. And they have now dropped 4 in a row. They haven't won since January 20th. So kind of a tough slide. But I mean, they're hanging around. They lost to Maryland by 11, and they're going to get a chance to bounce back with games against Nebraska and Northwestern, which are both winnable. So yeah, we'll see if with two wins there, they're back to 500. And
that's all you can ask for. Yeah, state basketball.
The Big Ten women's basketball, for some reason, is just like crazy.
Yeah,
yeah.
Like, did you guys see that thing about Caitlin Clark for Iowa? She's like the first player to average like 39-9 since Jordan in the 80s. So it's just like, it's ridiculous.
That's insane.
Yeah.
So they have Nebraska coming up February 3rd, which is tomorrow, on the road. Nebraska's not one of the better teams in the Big Ten, so maybe they can pick one up there.
And I think they've already played Northwestern in Evanston, and they beat them by 4. So
yeah, that was their last win. They're on a 4-game losing streak since.
So there you go. Bounce.
All right.
Full circle.
Let's get circle. We'll be at 500. We'll be at 500 next time.
Okay, guys, I think that was a pretty efficient sports run. I think we hit on everything. Charlie and Connor, thank you very much.
Hey, man, thanks for having me.
Thank you.
And rest in peace to Kurt Chandler. We talked about him in headlines as well. But awesome professor. I also had him for Comp 271, and I know Teagan shared her experience with him. Very special guy. Very nice guy.
Yeah, I had him on Zoom last year. He was pretty cool. That was my first class in college, so.
There you go.
Yeah, super, super cool guy, even though I never got to meet him in person.
And I think, yeah, it's for a lot of comm students, Comm 271 over in Forum Building is like their first experience in the College of Comm. I know it was mine. I think it was Matt DeSanto, Hope D'Amato, and Matt Ogden as well. I had that class with all of them. So, yeah, shout out to Kurt Chandler. Awesome.
Shout out.
Awesome man.
Rest in peace.
Just a good man. So, rest in peace. Thanks, guys.
All right, well, that was our sports update. Thank you to Will and Connor and Charlie. We are going to let our dear friend Matt Ogden go, get back to work. He's a busy boy. But, Matt, we appreciate you hanging out with us, making your little return. It's nice to see your sweet face.
Thank you, guys. It was great to be back. It was great to talk to Miller McCormick. It was great to see everyone virtually. I hope to be back in person one day, maybe. I do want to see the studio in person. Because again, I said I am jealous. Yeah. So
it's very different than the Zoom days, but big group now. Hope we're making you proud.
Oh, for sure, for sure. I'm incredibly proud of the leaps and bounds that this program has taken since my departure. It's honestly gotten bigger than I ever thought it was going to be. So, congrats, guys.
Couldn't have done it without you. Appreciate you. We'll let you go here. Appreciate you, Matt. Thank you to, see you, buddy. It was good to have Matt back. We are getting ready to wrap up here, but good night from the crew here. Long night, late night. Head to cafe after this to meet Ann White. Shout out Ann White. Good episode.
Yeah.
What do you think?
Yeah, it was interesting.
Yeah, really interesting. It was fun. We've been planning that one for a while. Shout out to the crew here in the studio. We got Will Pegler, Charlie Pegler, Hailey Stutzman, Teagan Staudenmeier, Jordan Mansberger and Connor Krause just head out.
Missing Shannon.
Yeah.
2 weeks in
Sister
a row.
Shannon is.
Sister Shannon has duties.
She has her sorority.
She's at her pinning ceremony.
Each to their own.
No, you said that wrong.
Each to their own?
No, to each their own.
What's the difference? Tell
you said
me how
each
it's.
To their own.
How's that grammatically incorrect?
It's not grammatically incorrect. It's just not the.
Each to their own.
Well, yeah, I guess that works.
Each
but
to
that's
their
just
own
not
opinion.
The saying.
Yeah.
It's to each their own.
Yeah, each to
that
their
works,
own.
I guess.
Hey. Each to their own. Yeah. Anyways, yeah, good episode. Monday night. Rest in peace to Kurt Chandler. Kurt Chandler was like one of those legendary Penn State professors, similar to Mike Poorman, Sam Richards, you know. Kurt, I never had class with Kurt, but I knew him through his connection with the film program and, you know, just he cared about everyone he talked to, and that's something that stands out. And I know that so many people have such great memories on him. So
yeah, it was. I didn't have him either, but it was nice to read through, like on Twitter, everyone telling their own stories about him and stuff.
Yeah, and I'm sure he knew how loved he was. Mm-hmm. He was beloved by this university, but yeah. Rest in peace. Thinking about his family. This has been another episode of Podward State. Thanks for tuning in. My name is Sam Brungo.
Grace Cunningham.
Take it easy, guys. Be safe. Have a good week.
See ya. It's a world. It's a love and a thing. There's a